Hey guys, welcome back to Lab Hours. Today the correlation mini lecture is up on deck. The Tommy triple that I have for you today is joint and marginal distributions, covariance, and correlation. We're going to take everything that we learned from the previous mini lecture about random variables, things like expected value and variance, and we're going to take those tools and use them to understand relationships between two different variables now. So let's go ahead and jump right in, but before we do, I just want to really quick warn you that if you didn't watch the last lecture, you don't have a good understanding of what expected value, variance, random variables are. This one might be a little tough for you, so you can go back and watch that one first. It might be helpful, but we're going to try to cruise through this one, make this one of the shorter ones, and the first thing on the Tommy triple are the joint and marginal distributions. Now, of course, from the distributions discussion we had in the last video, you know, I can take something like this from my little island, right? I can take my 50% of the households have zero kids, 30% have one kid, 20% have two kids, right? And I know that that is a distribution, but it is only a distribution of one variable, right? So this is just a single, it's a random variable's probability distribution, right? But what if I also know, for example, stuff about the adults in the households on my island? Let's say, for example, that the probability of K and A, the number of adults in a household. It goes from 1 to 2, for example, right? Let's say that the probability of K and A in the specific mathematical notation, which we like to give you before we give you the intuition and the ideas behind it, of course, you know, this would be the probability that the random variable K is equal to a specific value of K at the same time or intersect the random variable A, number of adults, is equal to a specific number of adults. And that is going to be equal to, again, of course, we're going to make a piecewise function, but this one's going to be a little bit bigger. Because I've got these, you know, three different variables that K can take, but I also know there's either one or two adults per household in my island. So I'm actually going to have six different things in this joint distribution. It's going to be every value of K with every value of A in each of their, like, unique combinations, right? So let's say, for example, that, let's say that I know 20% of the households have, and I'm going to use ordered pair notation here, 20% of the households have no kids and one adult. It's just a single adult, right? And then let's say that 30% of households have one kid, my bad, zero kid and two adults, right? We're going to keep this, you know, this is going to make sense in just a second, right? Let's say I also know, for example, that like, 10% of households have one kid and one adult. And then let's say that 20% of households have one kid and two adults, right? And then let's say 5% of the households on my island have two kids and one adult, you know, two and one. And then maybe the other 15% that we haven't covered yet is the two and two, right? Two kids, two adults, okay? This thing that I have just drawn for you right now, you're gonna recognize it looks like the distributions that we did back here, except you'll notice these ones were just with one single variable. One variable, one dartboard, one bracketed function, right? One piecewise function. But this one has to deal with two different variables. That's why we call it a joint distribution function, because the two variables are together, they're connected. They are jointly distributed, if you will, right? And so we're gonna actually use these joint distributions that we've gotten right here, where you split it down into each combination of kids and adults, or of X and Y. We're gonna use those to get things like covariance and correlation. But to get those things as well, we are also going to need individual statistics about each of these individual variables. So the question becomes, like, how do I take a joint PDF, or a joint probability distribution, right, and turn it down into just the single variables? Well, that's going to be called a marginal distribution. Now, hopefully you can tell I did a little trick here where I took this distribution that we know about from the island and I kind of incorporated it into building this joint PDF, right? Like, you can see, if I break it down to just the kid level, where it's just 0, 1, and 2, and I add up those values, you can hopefully see that they add up to these values that I have from the kids distribution that we worked on in the last video, right? And that's intentional, and that's by design. This k distribution right here, this one that we did in the past lecture, right? This distribution right here, the probability that k is equal to k 0.5, 0.3, 0.2, 0, 1, 2, that is the marginal distribution of k. If I were given, you know, to start this joint distribution, then I would write the probability of k, pk of k, if you will. This is the marginal distribution because we're going to ignore a and only look at k on the margin, right? We're only going to look at changes of k. We're going to ignore changes of a. And that's, of course, going to be equal to exactly what I've been drawing this whole time, 0.5, 0.3, 0.2. If k equals 0, if k equals 1, if k equals 2, right? This is familiar. This is something we've seen. But then the question is, well, how do I do the same thing for a? Well, notice, for every unique value of k, I grouped them together and added up the probabilities. And that's exactly what we're going to do for a here, right? If I wanted, for example, pa of a, that would be equal to, well, there's only two different values of a, right? We have 1 and we have 2. Easy peasy. So let's just add up those probabilities. Every time we see an a equals 1, let's just add all those up, and that's the probability that we see a equals 1, right? So let's do that really quick. A equals 1 here, here, and here. That's 0.05 plus 0.1 plus 0.2. That's going to be 0.25, or 0.35, my bad, because it's 0.2 plus 0.1 plus 0.05, right? So that's 0.35 if a equals 1. And then let's just go ahead and, for the sake of like beating this point home, right? 2, 2, 2, 0.15, 0.2, 0.3. So this is going to be 50, and then plus 15 is 0.65. One thing I want to stress about these marginal distributions is that you will hopefully notice each of them also covers 100% of the distribution. That also has to be true for the joint distribution, right? Like, they all have to add up to 100% to be valid probability distributions, right? Because if they don't add up to 100%, just like from last lecture, we could draw some kind of dartboard. And if they didn't add up to 100%, there'd be some weird region where we'd be like, what happens when I throw my dart at this point of the dartboard? And we'd be like, I don't know. And it's like, I think we should not use that dartboard, right? So the same is true for probability distribution functions, whether they are joint probability distribution functions between multiple variables. In this class, we're only really going to talk about two, but you could hypothetically have like an infinite number of variables here, right? Or just for distributions of one variable, they have to add up to 100%, right? If I drew this set, right, like this universal set, and I were able to like take this distribution and throw it onto here, then it's basically like, in fact, let's just try it, right? Let's try doing something like that. Why not? We could take the time. We could take the time, absolutely. 0.2, 0.3, 0.1, 0.2, 0.5, 0.15, let's go. So let's split this into 20 pieces. Why not, right? Here we have 4 pieces, and let's split each of them into 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Doot, doot, doot. Right, and we're gonna just go ahead and pretend that I have drawn these evenly. So each of these little rectangles is gonna represent 1/20th, or this like 5% of the joint distribution function, right? So let's give all of these little shapes, right? This one could be a star, this one could be a circle, this one can be a square, this one can be a triangle, this one could be a question mark, this one could be an exclamation point, right? So the star here is gonna cover 4 of these squares, right? So we'll have star, 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 right? And this is part of the intuition part, right? Because we've given you the math, and basically this is everything that we need to give you. And then the circle is going to cover 6 of these. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. The square is going to cover 2 of them. Square, square. Triangle is going to cover 4. Triangle, 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 triangle. And then the question mark has 1 of them, and the exclamation point has 3. Now, if you notice really quick, if I wanted, this is like the distribution, the joint distribution. I've taken these and I've split them up, and you know, so it could look something like this, right? Boom. Something like that, right? That's what this distribution would look like. But if I just wanted like the joint distribution of kids, right, well, the star and the circle have zero kids. So maybe I can take a different color really quick and just draw the block where there's zero kids. Something like that, right? Boom, there's the block with zero kids. The square and the triangle have one kid each. So let's draw the little block for the square and the triangle, right? Oop, that made a little curve. I gotta close the rectangle here, right? And then of course we'll fill in the rest with the part that has two kids. And you'll notice, you know, this is k equals 0, k equals 1, k equals 2. That looks a lot like this distribution right here, just kind of tilted on its side, right? That's exactly what these marginal distributions are doing. All they're doing is they're saying, okay, we're looking really narrowly down at like this exact specific combination of the two variables right now, right? Stars, circles, squares, triangles. But what if we just kind of zoom out and only look at k equals 0? Well, then it looks exactly the same as the distribution has looked previously. We could do similar things here, but I'm gonna leave that for you for an exercise. We don't quite have the time for that right now. But that's the idea of a joint distribution and a marginal distribution. If you want a marginal distribution, just add up all the probabilities of where one variable is the same, right? So for 0, 1, and 2, or just for 1 and 2, 1 and 2, 1 and 2, right? Two marginal distributions from one joint distribution. Let's go ahead and go check that off. That's everything we need today. Let's talk about covariance now. Covariance, of course, we're gonna start with the math. I'm gonna give you the formula, and then we're gonna talk about what we do to get the formula, right? So the formula for covariance, and here's the way that we write it, right? Sigma xy. Now, why we write it sigma xy is a great question. But basically, this is going to hopefully signal to you that the formula for covariance is gonna look a lot like the formula for variance, okay? Sigma xy is how we're denoting it right now. In the future, we'll use sxy. Just get used to that. Sigma xy is equal to, I'll also write like covariance of x and y, you could see it like that sometimes, is equal to the expected value of xy minus the expected value of x times the expected value of y. Now similarly, between covariance and variance, there is an alternate form of this formula right here. And on your homework, if you're in 378 right now, you will actually have an exercise of going from that one to this one. You're gonna do the exact same thing that you did with normal variance, except now there's also a y in it, right? Still the same thing, expected value of y turns into mu, mu is a constant, so on and so forth, right? But the really interesting thing here is that we have seen how to take the expected value of a single variable, right? We've done, you know, sum of k times the probability of seeing that k, right? But we haven't quite done that with two variables yet. So how do we do that? Well, let me show you. It's pretty easy. I'm gonna come over here and I'm gonna copy this distribution because it's the one that we're gonna use here. Let's copy that and we're gonna paste it a little bit smaller, right? Just so that we have more room to work. And this is gonna be the math, and then we'll talk about intuition, right? Because of course we do, right? So expected value of xy is equal to question mark, right? How do we do that? Well, the nice thing is we get to still use the exact same formula or idea of expected value that we've been using. There's a thing in the parentheses. In this case, it's called xy, or even better, we can call it ka, right? Ka in this case. We're gonna do ka instead of xy, just by virtue of the fact that we have called this kids and adults, right? So, what is the expected value of ka? Well, I know that the expected value of something is the sum across all the possible values of the thing, ka, times the probability of seeing that thing. Or specifically, that k takes on a certain value at the same time that a takes on a certain value, right? So, what do I do? First, let me take all the possible values of ka, k times a. Let's take all those possible values and line them up, right? Just like we've been doing before. 0 times 1, 0 times 2, 1 times 1, 1 times 2, that's gonna need more space, you know. And then we'll come down here and say 2 times 1 and 2 times 2, right? Those are all of the possible values of Ka that we get from this distribution. 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2, 0, 1, 0, 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. Easy peasy, right? multiply all of those by the probability of seeing them, right? So the probability that K is 0 and A is 1 at the same time is 0.2, or 20%. So let's do 0.2. The probability that K is equal to 0 and A is equal to 2 at the same time is right here. It's 30%, right? So let's multiply that by 0.3, and I'll just fill in the gaps for the rest of these. 0.1, 0.2, 0.05, 0.15. And then because this is an expected value, we just add them all up. So add them together. And this is going to be math that we can do mentally. So let's do that. Step one, of course, is that, and in fact, let me just switch back over to my red here. Those will cancel because they're multiplied by 0. 1 times 1 times 0.1 is 0.1. 1 times 2 times 0.2 is 0.4. 2 times 1 times 0.05 is 0.1. And 2 times 2 times 0.15 is going to be 0.6. So this expected value of k times a is going to be equal to 0.6 times plus 0.4 plus 0.1 plus 0.1. That's 1.2. I'll throw it in blue as well. 1.2. Now, intuitively, what does the expected value of Ka mean? Well, it's literally just the average value of K times A. If you took K and multiplied it by A and then averaged that, that's what this is. In terms of like actual intuition or meaning, there's not really a helpful way to like understand what that would be. Like, why would you ever want to multiply the number of kids by the number of adults in a household? I don't know. So that kind of limits the intuition that we can have on this one a little bit. But let's go ahead and keep that number safe up here, right? Boom, 1.2. And then let's just go ahead and calculate expected value of x and expected value of y. And here is where these marginal distribution ideas are going to pop in, right? So we know from the previous page, and I will just copy them both over really quick. We know the distribution of k, and in fact, from the last video, I'm just going to tell you that the expected value of k is equal to 0.7, okay? I just know that one, and we're going to save you some time. And then the expected value of a, let me just go copy that distribution, actually. If you don't know where I'm getting that 0.7 number, I'd encourage you to try to calculate it yourself using this distribution, but also I did it in the last video a bunch, so hopefully that won't be too crazy for you. Now, we have this marginal distribution that we made here. And again, if you've forgotten how to make it, we take all of the ones, all of the places where a shows up as being equal to 1, and we add them together, and we get this number. And then we get all the places where a is equal to 2, boom, 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 add them up, and we get this number. Easy peasy, right? So let's do the expected value. Of course, that's just going to be 1 and 2 times 0.35 and 0.65, and then add them together. This is going to be 0.35. 2 times 0.65 is going to be 1.3. So the expected value of y is going to be 1.65. Or the expected value of y, of course, I mean a here, right? 1.65. Cool. So that means I have everything I need to calculate covariance now, because covariance is, of course, just this formula here. So let's calculate that. Expected value of Ka, right? So let's actually write this. Sigma Ka is equal to expected value of Ka, which is 1.2, minus the expected value of x, which is 0.7, times the expected value of A, 1.65. And let's just go ahead and throw that in the calculator, because I don't want to do 0.7 times 1.65 in my head. 1.2 minus 0.7 times 1.65. Calculate. We get that the covariance of K and A, or sigma Ka, is equal to 0.045. What does that number mean? Well, the answer is not a lot. It doesn't really mean much, unfortunately. Covariance is just like a loose indicator of like the direction of a relationship between two variables, right? So we see if covariance is positive, this is another thing, covariance can be positive or negative. Right? If it looks like from what we've got here, and in fact, I've tried to make this fairly explicit, right? If there are more kids, if there are more adults in the household, we generally see fewer children, right? 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Whatever this relationship is, it's kind of difficult to parse out from this joint distribution, but this covariance is a helpful step in how to like determine that. It can be negative. Like if this number right here is bigger than this one, that can be negative. And for covariance, that's okay because covariance kind of measures like how k and a affect each other, right? When k goes up, a goes up because this is positive. But we can think of a world where if k went up, a could go down. Now, if you're smart, you'll remember from, or if you're just quick, right? You'll remember from last mini lecture that we talked about how variance can never be negative. And the reason for that is because I don't know if you've noticed, but like we use this sigma squared of k thing. You could also potentially write that as like the covariance between like k and k, where it's squared because like k is the same as itself, right? And so this idea of like covariance and how the variables affect each other can play in here. Variance can never be negative because if k goes up, maybe a goes down, but if k goes up, then k can't go down, right? So a variable can never move in an opposite direction from itself, which is why variance, sigma squared, can never be negative. But covariance is talking about two different variables and which way they go relative to each other, and so it totally can be negative. If they move in opposite directions, totally fine. So that's everything we need for covariance, but we want to make covariance like useful. We want to make it, we want to kind of standardize covariance into like units that we can use. So let's go check it off really quick. And let's talk about correlation. Because now that we understand what covariance is and like the formula for that, correlation, the math, super easy. We use rho, the Greek letter rho, to represent correlation. And the formula for correlation is just the covariance of two variables over the standard deviation of each of those variables multiplied together. So sigma kA over sigma k times sigma a, right? And what this does is it takes this kind of meaningless measurement of direction and like influence between k and a, and it standardizes them into units of standard deviations of each of k and a. What this does is it gives us this nice property where we always have it such that negative 1 is less than or equal to rho is less than or equal to 1. Rho, as the correlation coefficient, can never, ever, ever be greater than or less than 1 or negative 1, respectively, because we've standardized it in such this way so that it can be like a useful measurement in units we understand. I'll talk about more about that in just a second, but let's finish calculating the correlation between kids and adults based on this joint distribution. So the things we already know covariance of Ka. We found that that was 0.045, right? We don't quite have standard deviations of K and A, but really quick, I can give you the following. From the last lecture, I know that the standard deviation of K was about 0.78. So let's just steal that one really quick and save ourselves some work. Standard deviation of K was equal to 0.78 approximately, right? So let's just do sigma a as a quick refresher, right? So we have this distribution where it's 0.35, 0.65, if a equals 1, if a equals 2. And you remember that the formula for sigma, which is standard deviation, is of course we need to do the square root of the variance of a, which is equal to the square root of the expected value of a squared minus the squared expected value of a. We know that expected value of a from back here was 1.65, so we have part of that formula already, right? Minus 1.65 squared. But what do I do for expected value of a squared? Well, that's easy. I take the thing, write down all of its possible values, so 1 squared, 2 squared, then multiply it by their relative probabilities, 0.35 and 0.65. 0.35, 0.65, and then I add them together, okay? So I have 1 times 0.35, that's 0.35, and then 2 times 0.65, well, 2 squared times 0.65, so 2 times 0.65 was 1.3, so 4 times 0.65 is going to be 2.6. 2.6, add them together, I get 2.95. So let's take that number and throw it up here, 2.95. And remember, this is going to be one of those numbers that can never be negative, so this is looking like a good sign. Let's just do that really quick. I'm going to skip some steps and throw all of this into my calculator. 2.95 minus 1.65 squared is going to be about equal to 0.47. In fact, we'll call it 0.48 by rounding. So now we have that the sigma A, hopefully this was a nice little review for you calculating standard deviations, is approximately equal to 0.48. So what is correlation? What is the correlation between the number of kids and the number of adults in a household on my island? Well, it's pretty easy. 0.045 over 0.78 times 0.48. Easy peasy, right? Throw that in the calculator. And then we'll talk about the intuition and what it actually means in a second. 0.48, calculate. It's about equal to 0.12. So we have rho is equal to 0.12-ish. What does that mean? Well, as I'm sure you can imagine, knowing that negative 1 is less than or equal to rho is less than or equal to 1, I'm sure you can imagine or guess that a correlation of 1 or negative 1 would be perfect positive or negative correlation. That would indicate that when x moves, y moves all the time in a proportional way. What it literally, like, definitionally means is if kids goes up by 1 times the standard deviation of kids, then we can predict that the number of adults in a household will also go up by 0.12 standard deviations of adults. Correlation is a measurement of relationship between two variables in units of standard deviations. If rho were 1, then x could go up 1 standard deviation of x, and y would go up 1 standard deviation of y. Now, what the standard deviation of x and y are doesn't really matter, because rho, of course, is a measure of correlation. If I were to draw you this graph right here, and I plotted some data point, and over here I put k, and up here I put a, for example, and I gave you some data points that kind of follow this line, you would say, oh, these data points basically follow a one-to-one correlation. Super cool, right? Every time k moves out, a moves up. It might move up differently. The slope could be 1. The slope isn't really relative here. Isn't really relevant here, right? So these variables are these two variables would be perfectly correlated on this graph. But I haven't labeled them yet. You know that they're correlated because you can tell when k moves, a moves some amount, and it's consistent, right? I could put like 50 and 1,000 here, and I could put like 200 there, or I could change that to this, 2, 3, and as long as it stays linear, they're still perfectly correlated. So again, correlation is a measurement of a relationship between two variables in units of standard deviation. So this rho of 0.12 specifically means if k were to go up by 1 standard deviation of k, we could predict that a would also go up by 0.12 standard deviations of a, and vice versa. If a were to go up 1 standard deviation of a, we would predict k would go up 0.12 standard deviations of k. And this reverse relationship doesn't make too much sense, except for when you think about the fact that there's variance in k and there's variance in a, and that's what we're capturing here. And their covariance is supposed to indicate like how much of that is a together thing. And so this fraction of togetherness in terms of the total variation of the two tells us that, like, you know, we see k move and we predict this 0.12 from a, or we could do it vice versa. But that's just kind of the idea. That whole sentence, that little diatribe didn't make too much sense. But basically what it's trying to say is that, like, a lot of the variation in K isn't going to affect A. In fact, probably 0.78, like 78% of the variation in K isn't going to affect A, right? But some of it is. And so we use these units of standard deviations to like predict those together movements, right? So that's going to cover everything for correlation. We got the math and kind of the intuition. We'll talk more in the next lecture about like conditional distributions and like causation. So just because these two variables are correlated doesn't necessarily imply that one causes the other to move, right? They just happen to move together, and that's what we've talked about today. Just relationships between two variables, not whether one causes the other to move. We haven't done anything like that, but just like, do they move together? Do we see them together? Hey guys, really quick, before I end the lecture, I know it's going a little bit long, but there are two important things I wanted to tell you about. You'll recall from the previous mini lecture that we talked about algebra rules and things for like passing operators through and stuff. And actually there are some quick notes I wanna make about that for covariance and correlation. One thing I want to point out to you really quick is that if I had the covariance operator COV, is kind of how we denote it, for x and y, right? We know that it's the expected value of xy minus the expected value of x times the expected value of y. But what if I had something crazy like 14x minus 2 and like 3y? Well, the really interesting thing that I get to do is I can follow most of the same pieces of the algorithm. So the first thing I would do for covariance is I would break it up at the pluses and minuses, right? Here's a minus. So I'd break it up into the covariance of 14x and 3y plus the covariance of negative 2 and 3y. Now hopefully you can guess, because this is a variance and it's a measure of how two things move together. If negative 2 is a constant and it never moves, its covariance with a variable that does move is obviously going to be 0, because 2 never moves, y, 3y can move, so we get to eliminate that and call that 0. The much more interesting thing is here on covariance, what do I do with these constants on the x and y, or on the k and a, or whatever it is? The nice thing about covariance is that you can just pull them straight out. So this covariance of 14x, 3y turns into 4 times 13 is 30 plus 12 is 42, 42 covariance of x and y. You don't have to square anything for covariance, because again, you're only seeing these once. You're seeing a 14, you're seeing a 3. Maybe even if this were a negative 3, this would turn into negative 42, right? Because you're not squaring anything. You're just going to pull 14 off of x, 3 off of y. In variance, you'd square it, because it would be more like pulling 14 off of x and then pulling another 14 off of x if you were doing the covariance of 14x and 14x, stuff like that, right? So that's going to be the note for covariance, is just break it apart at the pluses and minuses. Covariance of a variable and a constant never moves, so it's 0. And then you can just straight up pull out the constants like an expected variable. Do it for both sides, right? And then the thing with correlation actually really has to do with this like graph that I showed you. The really cool thing about correlation is if I have this correlation operator, which is usually C-O-R-R, because my R's look like V's sometimes, the correlation of like 12x and 13y is actually equal to the correlation of x and y. Because again, with this graph, if I were to scale this and I said this was 1 and this was like 3, and I said that this was 10, if I were to scale k by 12 and I called this 12 and I called this 36, like they're still correlated just as strongly on the line. They move together. They move together in the same way relative to their standard deviation. But scaling this just scales the standard deviation, so it doesn't actually change rho at all. The only thing that would change with correlation, the only thing you pull out, so basically, if I had something like, you know, let me make a little bit of space over here. If I had something like the correlation of 14x minus 4 and negative 2y, the only thing that will change with this correlation is the direction of the correlation. It's never going to change in scale, right? So let's work this out using our little algorithm. Let's split it at the pluses and minuses, keep the minuses inside. Correlation of 14x and negative 2y plus the correlation of negative 4 and negative 2y. Now hopefully you can tell, because the covariance of this would turn into 0, definitely the correlation would also turn into 0. So this correlation term goes away. Constants don't correlate with variables. That's not too tough to get, hopefully. This thing right here, I can scale this by 14, and it will not change the correlation, so I can just get rid of that correlation, that negative 14. And again, I could scale this y-axis by 2, and as long as the line stays the same, which it will, I can just get rid of the 2. However, if I did the negative y, I would have to like flip this line. So that actually will change correlation. It will change it from a positive correlation to a negative correlation, where if k goes up, negative a goes down, right? Because when positive k goes up, positive a goes up from this line. But x, or k, right? If I had k here and negative a, then the correlation between k and negative a, k and negative a, is going to be flipped. That's all it basically turns into. So that would turn into the correlation, or that is to say, pull out the negative. Negative correlation of x and y. So just a quick recap. I added about 5 minutes. Apologies for that one because I was happy the other one was a little bit shorter. I'm going to have to go back and edit this in. That's fine. But just the algebra rules here for covariance, split at the pluses and minuses, get rid of the constants. And then the constants that are attached to the variables, you can just pull straight out, including negatives. And then for correlation, split at the pluses and minuses, get rid of the constants. And then for the constants that are actually attached to the variables, the scale does not matter, but the direction does. So only pull out negatives. And again, if you pull out two negatives, it's going to be equal because the negatives would cancel, right? So that's everything I have to add. I'll go ahead and go back to me wrapping up the lesson just a second ago right now. That's going to be everything for today's mini. We covered the Tommy triple, joined marginal distributions, covariance, and correlations. Thanks for stopping by. If you have any questions and you're in the class, email tmorg.ta@gmail.com. If you're not in the class, email labhours@tmorg.org. Either way, happy to answer your questions. Be sure to subscribe if you like the lectures and drop the video a like. Comment any questions if you don't want to send an email. I mean, it is 2022, so, you know, do you. I'll answer any comments, right? Thanks for stopping by Lab Hours again. Hopefully you'll stop by next time. We're going to talk about conditional distributions and causation, so it'll be a fun one. We'll hope to see you there. Thanks for watching. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.